हरे कृष्णा। सो टुडे वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम चैप्टर 6 एंड टेक्स्ट 1। श्री भगवान वाचा अनाश्रिता कर्म फलम कार्यम कर्म करोति या सा सन्यासी च योगी च न निराग्नेर न चक्रियः। श्री भगवान उवाच अनाश्रिता कर्म फलम कार्यम कर्म करोति या सा सन्यासी च योगी च न निराग्नेर न चक्रियः। ट्रांसलेशन: द सुप्रीम पर्सनैलिटी ऑफ गॉड इट सेड, वन हु इज अनअटैच्ड टू द फ्रूट्स ऑफ हिज वर्क एंड हु वर्क्स एज ही इज ऑब्लिगेटेड इज इन द रिनाउंस्ड ऑर्डर ऑफ लाइफ एंड ही इज द ट्रू मिस्टिक, नॉट ही हु लाइट्स नो फायर एंड परफॉर्म्स नो ड्यूटी। परपोर्ट बाय एसी भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद। श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। इन दिस चैप्टर द लॉर्ड एक्सप्लेन्स दैट द प्रोसेस ऑफ द एट फोल्ड योगा सिस्टम इज अ मीन्स टू कंट्रोल द माइंड एंड द सेंसेस। हाउएवर दिस इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट फॉर पीपल इन जनरल टू परफॉर्म, एस्पेशली इन द एज ऑफ कली। Although the Eightfold Yoga System is recommended in this chapter, the Lord emphasizes that the process of Karma Yoga or acting in Krishna consciousness is better. Everyone acts in this world to maintain his family and their paraphernalia, but no one is working without some self-interest, some personal gratification, be it concentrated or extended. The criterion of perfection is to act in Krishna consciousness and not with a view to enjoying the fruits of work. To act in Krishna consciousness is the duty of every living entity because all are constitutionally parts and parcels of the Supreme. The parts of the body work for the satisfaction of the whole body. The limbs of the body do not act for self-satisfaction, but for the satisfaction of the complete whole. Similarly, the living entity who acts for satisfaction of the supreme whole and not for personal satisfaction is the perfect sannyasi, the perfect yogi. The sannyasis sometimes artificially think that they have become liberated from all material desires, from all material duties, and therefore they cease to perform Agnihotra Yajnas, fire sacrifices. But actually, they are self-interested because their goal is to become one with the impersonal Brahman. Such a desire is greater than any material desire, but it is not without self-interest. Similarly, the mystic yogi who practices the yoga system with half-open eyes, seizing all material activities, desires some satisfaction for his personal self. But a person acting in Krishna consciousness works for the satisfaction of the whole without self-interest. A Krishna conscious person has no desire for self-satisfaction. His criterion of success is the satisfaction of Krishna, and thus he is the perfect sannyasi or perfect yogi. Lord Chaitanya, the highest perfectional symbol of renunciation, prays in this way: Nadhanam Najinam Nasundarim Kavitam Va Jagadisha Kamayi Mama Janmani Janmanishwari Bhavatar Bhaktir Ahaitukitul. Almighty Lord, I have no desire to accumulate wealth, nor to enjoy beautiful women, nor do I want any number of followers. What I want only is the causeless mercy of your devotional service in my life, birth after birth. Matiji, I am audible, na?
Yes, that's fine. Carry on.
Okay.
Thank you.
Om Jnanati Mirandasya Jnananjana Shilakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Meena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Namo Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Nitinamine. नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीनबंधु जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुस्तुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिय वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यस्य कृपा सिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः मुखं करोति वाचानां पंगुं लंगायते गिरिं यत्कृपा तमहं वंदे श्रीगुरुं दीनतारिणं परमानंदमीश्वरं श्रीचैतन्यं ईश्वरं थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर Thank you very much to Mataji for giving me this chance for sharing some of Bhagavad Gita talks today on Bhagavad Gita chapter 6, text 1. If somebody gets the mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Mukham Karoti Vachanam, this verse is perfectly befitting for me today, because if a dumb man can speak Vedas, glorify about Vedas, and a lame man can climb up the big mountains, if we have the mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, so and the spiritual master. So today I am very incapable, but by Her Grace Lavanglata Mataji, I am trying to. I'll be going to speak few words. So I seek blessings from all the devotees who is going to listen and who are here listening, and my spiritual master, His Holiness Bhagaswami Maharaj. And Srila Prabhupada, so that I can speak few words in the glorification of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and right words may come out in right time. So, and if there are any errors, please tolerate me and forgive me, and please bless me so that I can properly speak. Hare Krishna. So today we are in sixth chapter, and Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Anashrita Karma Phalam Karyam Karma Karotiya Sa Sanyasi Cha Yogi Cha Na Niragnir Na Cha Kriyaha. So in the fifth chapter, Krishna ended up explaining about Ashtanga Yoga in verses 27 and 28. And on 29th chapter, Shloka, Krishna is explaining about Bhakti Yoga. So now in the sixth chapter, Krishna is speaking about he's describing about Ashtanga Yoga. So advancement in the stage of yoga. So sixth chapter has 47 verses, And the first, it is called Dhyana Yoga. So the first 1 to 9 shlokas, let's have one small overview of 6 chapters. So 1 to 9 shlokas, verses 1 to 9, they speak about Aruruksha stage to Aruda stage. So Aruruksha stage is the beginning stage of the ladder. If we envision the yoga as the ladder, yoga process as the ladder, then Aruruksha stage is the beginning stage of the ladder. And Aruda stage is one who is situated on the ladder. So, like there is Ratharuda, charioteer being situated on the chariot. And there is Garuda Ruda. That means when Vishnu, Lord Vishnu is traveling, he is Garuda Ruda. That means he is situated on the Garuda. So verse 1 is speaking about renouncing the world. How it's going through discussing the topic of how we renounce the world. So Dhyana Yoga is mainly about renouncing the world through exclusively the process of meditation. But there is a preliminary purification involved. So verses 10 to 32 is talking about practice to perfectional stage, wherein 10 to 15 is realization of Brahman and 16 to 23 is realization of Paramatma, and 24 to 32 is realization of Bhagavan. So now from 33 to 37, Arjuna put some questions about mind, how to deal with mind. And because mind is the main obstacle on our way to progress in any field. So from 38 to 45, it is talking about how if the yogi gets deviated, what will be his destination, where he will go. Then 46 and 47, Krishna is explaining about the topmost yogi. So at the last, after explaining elaborately about the Ashtanga Yoga process, Krishna is coming to the point that Bhakti Yoga is the best. This creates a way for Krishna to explain about Bhakti Yoga in chapter 7. So coming back to Aruruksha to Aruda stage from verses 1 to 9, let's talk from today's verse, Anashrita Karma Phalam. So Krishna is telling that Anashrita means to work without the expectation for phala, for fruits. So whenever we are working, whenever somebody is working, we are a person is what is the motivation behind work? What is the motivation for anybody's work? The motivation is our fruits, that we get good fruits or bad fruits. Nobody expects bad fruits, but the results of the work is our motivation so that we can work. So if we take some example, like if there is a World Cup champion, and if we ask the team, if they ask the head of the team that what was his motivation and how, what was the secret behind his success, so he would say that from my childhood I have been dreaming the World Cup, cricket World Cup in my hand, and that was my dream, and because of that motivation I got the success today. So he is ashrita on the result. So he's working, being sheltered for the result. So Bhagavad Gita is not against achievements. Bhagavad Gita is promoting that our outer achievements should not hamper our inner motivations. It should not hamper this outer motivation, outer achievements, plannings. It results in hampering our spiritual advancement. So Ashtanga, Krishna is explaining now the process of Ashtanga Yoga as a means to control our mind and senses. So Ashtanga Yoga process involves eightfold system. If we follow, Prabhupada says, if we follow this Ashtanga Yoga process very the regulative principles very perfectly, then we can achieve perfection in the eightfold mystic powers. Ashtanga Yoga involves, like, we can become lighter than the lightest, like a cotton. We can become heavier than the heaviest, like a stone. We can expand ourselves. Yam, niyam, pranayam. We can expand ourselves. Like Kardama Muni, he expanded himself into 9 forms. And the yogi can also create certain planets. Like Prabhupada is explaining that Vishwamitra Muni, he thought, why a living entity has to be for 10 months in the womb? Let me create a man from a palm tree. So he got a man from a palm tree. That was his mystic power. So there are yogis who have a lot of mystic powers. Like Saubari Muni, he was in under the water, but he fell down by the vision of 2 mating fishes. And there are many big yogis, but everybody was vanquished because with yoga, you may not result in, you cannot control your senses. So Ashtanga Yoga process is there. We know that pastime, which Prabhupada says always, that there was a one yogi who practiced his yoga for 20 years. And he comes to the village and he tells everybody that I'm going to show you some magic, that I'm going to walk on the water. So one villager comes out and he says, you have practiced this for 20 years to walk on water from here to there, but I can go on that shore just with 2 paise. So all your hard work is worth 2 paise. So these yogic powers, mystics, is worth 2 paise. It can vanquish any time. There are how to control this mind. Krishna is telling Ashtanga Yoga as a means to control mind and senses. But we may practice many Ashtanga Yoga processes. But in this age of Kali, where people are so dumb and numb, like Bhagavatam is telling, Praina Alpa Ayusha Sabhya Kalo Yusmin Yugejana Manda Sumanda Matayo Manda Bhagyahi Upadrita. In this age, people are so drowned to death that they have very short span and they are very unlucky. They are not lucky in their activities. And they're numb, they're dumb, dull-hearted. They cannot get anything in their minds very quickly. Everything people keep forgetting every other minute. So how can we expect a mind which is so restless? Arjuna is going to tell on 6.34 that mind is so restless. Chanchalam hi mana Krishna pramatha balavad dridam. Tasyaham nigraham manye vayur ivashu dushkaram. It is so restless. Mind is so restless, so obstinate, so strong, so flickering that he says to Krishna, that how can I subdue my mind? How can I concentrate? It is more uncontrollable than the wind. So in such condition, how can we expect the people of Kali Yuga, who are so demonic and who are so numb and dull-headed, to focus on Ashtanga Yoga process? So the only solution is for Kali Yuga is what Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Harir Nama, Harir Nama, Harir Nama, Eva Kevalam. Kalo Nasteva, 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 Gati Ranyada. So Krishna has invested all his powers. Nam Namakari Nija Sarva Shaktis. Krishna has invested all his powers in the holy name. Tatra Pita Niyamita Smaranena Kala. There are no as such hard and fast rules. Anytime, anywhere you can take up this holy names of Krishna. In Chaitanya Charitamrita it is said, na? Kali Kale Nama Rupe Krishna Avatar. Krishna Nama Kare Sarva Jagata Nistar. So Krishna is descending, incarnating in the form of holy names. And he is giving us the chance to directly associate with him through holy name. And if one does this, one gets delivered. Jagata Nistar, he gets delivered from this material existence. Kalera Dosha Nidhe Rajan Asti Eko Mahan Guna. Kirtanya Deva Krishna Syat Mukta Sangha Param Vrajet. This Kali Yuga is endowed. This is the treasure house for all the dosha, means all the misgivings. You can easily find all kinds of misgivings if you want to find. In this Kali Yuga, we can easily find. But there is one very good quality about this Kali Yuga. That is, Kirtana Deva Krishna Sriyam. Just by taking the names, holy names of Krishna, just by chanting the holy names, just by performing Sankirtan Yagya, one can be delivered from this greatest ocean of material existence. So that is the only way by which we can fix up our restless mind. You see, mind is so turbulent. It is more turbulent like a monkey. For example, if we tell our hands to lift, immediately our hands will lift. If we tell our feet that let's go walk up to the temple, it will agree. If we tell our eyes, okay, focus on this, maybe it will agree. But our mind is so restless and so demanding that it's only going to dictate. It's never going to listen to what good instructions you're giving. Mind is a person. It involves a great deal to train the mind. So if you take a cycle, if we want to buy one cycle, if we buy a 2,000 rupees cycle, or we can also buy a 50,000 worth cycle, like a sports cycle. So what is the important element of that cycle? Important element is the inflated tire. The tire has to be inflated and nice so that the tire cycle is working, whether it be 2,000 or what, 50,000. So if the tire is punctured, then there is a great deal of struggle to bring it back, even to the repair shop. So if the mind has puncture, it can never focus on any activity, be it for Krishna or be it for yoga. So how to fix this puncture? There's a very minute, insignificant hole which only an expert mechanic professional can fix it. So our mind's rupture, our mind's punctures can be only fixed if we take shelter of a sadhu guru. If we take the shelter of he's a doctor, he can treat us. He can find our ruptures and he can treat us so that we fix our mind at the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of God. So Sadhuguru is always coming to help, to save us. There is a good pastime narrated by Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. He says that one friend comes to another friend. His name is Kamini Mohan. So they stay near to Kulia. So the friend requests his friend Kamini Mohan that come, let's go to Mayapur Dham. There is one saint, there is one sadhu who has come and he is preaching on transcendental subject matters. Let's go and take some, let's get enlightened from him. So Kamini Mohan, he is very lazy and he doesn't want to leave the comfort of his house. So he says, next time, today I'm not very well. So he understands that he doesn't want to leave his comforts. So the friend, he tries to make some, some plan. So he tells that let's go to Kulia. On the bank of Kulia, there is fun fair. So we can have a lot of amusements and recreations. Let's go there. So immediately for enjoyment, Kamini Mohan agrees. Okay, let's go. We'll have enjoyment, fun. So when they go to the fun fair after having finished all the enjoyments, the friend tells, let's go to Sri Mayapur now. We can cross the Ganges easily now from here. And we can take darshan of Sri Dham Mayapur. And we can see Lord Chaitanya's birthplace. We can see Chand Gassi's tomb, everything. So Kamini Mohan realizes that his friend is very determined to take him across Ganges. And he also contracts with some other plan. He says, you know, actually, I am very... I cannot get into boat. I have never boarded boats, and I get dizziness. I get nausea. I get I am afraid of drowning, and I get palpitations on my body when I get into the boats. Now it is rainy season. So when the water gets dry in winter season, we can easily walk on this. There will be no water. We can easily walk to this Mayapur Dham. At that time, we can go. Then we can see all the places and resting places. So the friend says, okay, the water will never get dried. So it can never happen that you will ever go to Sri Dham Mayapur. So please stop this insincerity and hypocrisy. So you can never go to the river will never get dried, and you can never go to Mayapur. So the saints, the sadhus are always trying to help us, help the fallen people. But everybody, the material people are so engrossed in material life that they don't want to leave up their comfort zones. They don't want to leave out of their mind's demands. And they are so focused on their self-centered life, self-interested life. Either it may be concentrated or extended. They don't want to leave the comfort zone. But the sadhu is always there helping us, training our mind. So so what is the way to engage our disturbed mind? The only way is that we can fix it up in karma yoga. Because Ashtanga Yoga is not going to work. So let's fix it up in Karma Yoga, that is action in Krishna consciousness. So Jivera Swarupo Hai Nitya Krishna Das. So our constitutional position is that we are eternally parts and parcels of the Supreme Whole. Prabhupada explains that if we have some problem to our finger, then if we can put $1,000, how many our dollars, $100, to get it done, to get it fixed, because it is our part, so we need to be fixed up. So, but if this finger is separated from our body, and if somebody tramples it, kicks it, we never protest. It's okay. It is no longer our part. It is a separated part. It doesn't matter. Similarly, the living entity's constitutional position is he is the part and parcel of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Mama Ivamsha Jiva Loke Jiva Bhuta Sanatana. He is eternally fragmental part. And its duty, being a fragmental part, its duty is to serve the Supreme Whole. If he serves the Supreme Whole, then he is called a perfect sannyasi or a perfect yogi. Sannyasi means rejection. and yogi means connection. So one who is properly situated in the service of Krishna is a yogi as well as sannyasi, because he is rejecting the material sense gratificatory allurements. So one cannot claim a sannyasi or a grihastha or any ashram, one cannot claim if he is not dovetailing his activities in the service of Krishna. Artificially, Prabhupada says, if a sannyasi, impersonalist, he has to perform many agnihotras, many sacrifices. But artificially, if he thinks that he is liberated and he doesn't need to perform any sacrifices, then he is not liberated. Without performing devotional activities, one cannot be liberated. So it is the consciousness which matters. It is not the dress which matters. One can be in saffron dress but meditating on the sense objects. But one can be in grihastha ashram. He can be called also as a sannyasi. Like Prabhupada says, one time he was next to the window and he had tears in his eyes. So the disciple asked Prabhupada that, what is the reason behind the tears in your eyes? So he said that, I see my girls and boys, they don't have any winter warm clothes, they don't have socks, they don't have proper jackets, and they used to wear in the olden days different socks. They used to have one washing machine, the disciples, proper disciples, and they used to wash all the clothes in one washing machine, and whatever comes out and whoever gets it first was theirs. So they used to have very sacrificing, very renounced lifestyle. So when Prabhupada saw them in winters, and they used to go in that way for distributing books, not caring about themselves. And after distributing books, the disciples, the young girls, they never keep anything for themselves, for their sense gratification. Even one penny, they used to return it back to Srila Prabhupada. So Prabhupada got tears in his eyes that they are no less than sannyasis, because they are not keeping anything for themselves. Everything is devoted at the service of Guru and Krishna. So sannyasi is not one who is sitting in a forest, like Krishna himself is going to explain in 6.11 and 12. What is the process of yoga and where one has to sit in a secluded place, and which is the sacred place, and how to sit. He is telling that one should sit in a sacred place. One should sit in a secluded place. One should lay down kusha grass and top of that some deer skin on top of that soft cloth. And the asan should be not too high, not too low. So such circumstances, such situations, where can we find? We cannot go to the forest to perform some yogic practices to become sannyasi. The best sacred place in this Kali Yuga is temple. This is Nirguna, the place where there is no materialism. This is transcendental. This is vibrated with mode of goodness. So temple is the place where it is sacred place. We cannot go to forest. We can be there in the temple and chant. So our mind, it depends. The sannyasi or grihastha, If grihastha doesn't follow the rules of grihastha ashram, he'll be called as grihamedi. We can see the lifestyle of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. He had 8 children, but and he was an advocate. His lifestyle was so so deep and so scheduled, so busy, and he wrote so many literatures. So it is not that one should not become a grihastha, or in grihastha ashram he cannot be called as a renounced. If one practices the principles of grihastha ashram, and the owner, the husband thinks the dependents and the wife as not object of his sense gratification, but only as as the servants of the Lord, then he is not less than a sannyasi. And if he gives all his fruits for the service of Guru and Krishna, then he is no less than a sannyasi. It is the consciousness which matters, not the dress. But on the other hand, if somebody is in sannyas ashram and he is meditating on the sense objects, although being in that ashram, he is not following the rules of that ashram, he may not be called as sannyasi or brahmachari. So the most important thing is our inner aspirations, motivations. So Krishna is telling here, now because we speak about impersonalists, sannyasis. Impersonalists, they are demanding. They want to be merging into the body of Krishna. So, but the devotees, they don't want anything other than the service, unalloyed, uninterrupted service to Krishna. So, Krishna asks Prahlad Maharaj, that my dear boy, you have undergone many sufferings because of me. So, kindly ask anything from me. I am ready to give. I am very pleased on you. So Prahlad Maharaj says that, my dear Lord, my dear Master, I am not here making any business, mercantile business with you, so that I am awaiting for some remuneration from you. My service is, my love to you is unalloyed and unmotivated. So bhakti means like that. Whenever we are doing any service, we should not be motivated. Like Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj explains that pastime story, that one landlord comes and gives this bananas, Amritsari, delicious bananas to the priest. And he says, you kindly offer and I'll come back. There'll be some guests and I'll come back and collect them. But the priest, he becomes so greedy. He locks himself the altar and he thinks that, oh, I have not relished this bananas. They are so delicious. And I'm sure that the landlord must have not counted them. So let me enjoy some bananas. He will not count. So he starts to relish them. And the landlord had some doubt and he came upon him. The altar was bolted from inside. And he's shouting, yelling that, oh, please open, who is there inside? And because the thieves are always in anxiety to be caught. So he already was chewing and he started shouting out of fear that, oh, I'm not eating bananas. I'm not eating bananas. So who has asked him that he's eating bananas or not? So actually, there are three kinds of people. Bhogi, Tyagi, and Bhakta. So, Prabhupada says Bhogi and Tyagi, both are bogus. Bhogi, he goes to the neighborhood and he thinks, oh, this TV is mine, this fridge is mine, this AC is mine, everything is mine, I want to enjoy. And Tyagi, he thinks that he goes to the neighborhood and he thinks that, oh, I don't want this AC, I don't want this fridge, I don't want this computer. So this is not anyways yours. Why are you rejecting? This is not yours. Why are you claiming this? I don't want this. I don't want this. So in this material world, in this world, nothing is yours. What is the right for you to claim that I should get this, I should get that? Everything is Krishna's property. Even the sunshine is Krishna's. We are so obligated to everything, every act. Sunshine or the moonshine or the vegetables we read in 15th chapter. Everything is Krishna's. So nothing, we cannot claim anything. But the bhaktas, the third varieties, when they go to the neighborhood, they will not claim this is mine, I don't want this. They will tell that, okay, let me use it for the service of Krishna. So anasaktasya vishyan karyam karma karotiya. What is that shloka which says phalgum vairagya yuktam vairagya muchyate? Anything which we should not have a sense of possessiveness. Everything should be dovetailed in the service of Krishna. That is called yukta vairagya. best vairagya. So this vairagya, renounced mood, how can we develop? If we are fixed up in the service of Krishna, we fix our mind at the lotus feet of Krishna, then Vasudeva Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojita Janayati Ashu Vairagyam Jnanam Cha Yad Havitukam. Jnana and Vairagya will automatically come. If somebody is devotedly, unmotivatedly engaged in the service, what is that shloka which says that karmana manasagira nikleshoshu api avastashu jivan muktasya uchyate. Even in this material body, if one is engaged 24 hours a day in the service of Krishna, then with body, mind and words, even in this material body, he is liberated. So we can see Mahaprabhu is the symbol of renunciation. He is a chudamani, the jewel among the renunciates. He says that na dhanam, na janam, na sundarim, kavitam va jagadisha kamaye. I don't want any wealth, followers, women. We can see Gaurangira Bhaktagana Vairagya Pradhan Jahan Teki Tushtahoy Gaura Bhagwan. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is very, very pleased, very happy when he sees that his devotees have so much supreme renounced mood. We can see how Ramananda Rai, although being governor of South India, he resigned his governorship. Although being the ministers, Rup Sanatan Tyaktva Purna Ashesha Mandala Pateshanim Sadat Tuchavat. Although being the supreme the ministers of Bengal, they gave up their positions. Sanatan Goswami, after struggling so hard, when he came to Varanasi to meet Mahaprabhu, Rup Goswami had arranged some coins. We know that pastime, how with great struggle, after passing many thieves, after risking his life, crossing the boats, he had some 4 golden coins, and he sent his servant Ishan back also. He came finally, he came to between his brother-in-law's house, Srikanta. He told that leave up this messy dress and be like a gentleman. He says, no, not even a moment I can be here. At once I need to go to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So when he comes, Mahaprabhu was at the house of Tapan Mishra. He was at the house of Chandrasekhar Azad. And Mahaprabhu says, go at the door, there is some Vaishnava, some devotee. And he finds, no, there is nobody. So he says, is there anybody who is there? So take him inside. So Chandrasekhar Azad, he says that Mahaprabhu is calling me, and Sanatana Goswami, he was very pleased, very happy. And after everything, all the dealings, loving dealings, Mahaprabhu told to give him a bath and everything, get him ready. So after that, Chandrasekhar Azad gives him expensive quilt. And when Mahaprabhu keeps on noticing that expensive quilt, Sanatan Goswami feels embarrassing, and he goes to the bank of a river, and he exchanges it with some other mendicant. He takes his torn quilt and gives up his expensive quilt. So they were very renounced. Even Raghunath Das Goswami, what was his process of begging? With great difficulty, he reached Mahaprabhu, and he started begging from the food stores, and that also he stopped. Then he took the food which was rejected from the Jagannath Prasad, which was thrown in the drainage. That food, that Mahaprasad, he collected, Raghunath Das Goswami, and he used to go to the ocean, and there he used to wash that and squeeze out, and whatever was left, he used to eat that. So much renounced mood they had. So Raghunath Das Goswami was a very big son of a very rich personality. So that doesn't mean that we need to be so, we have to not do anukaran, we have to take anusharan, we have to take shelter, we should not imitate them. So nowadays people get afraid that, oh, you're married to Krishna, So we say when we are distributing books, how can we get married? Is it so cheap to marry Krishna? It's not so easy. But yes, if there is a chance, if we faithfully hear Harikatha, which lady would not have Krishna, if we hear his childhood pastimes, which lady would not want to have him as his child? And if we hear his sportive activities, which kid would not want to have Krishna as his friend? And if somebody faithfully hears Krishna's amorous pastimes, which girl would not have Krishna as the love of her life? So it all depends on faithful hearing. But however, we never hear faithfully, attentively, and repeatedly. So the devotees of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they are highly renounced. And we know the pastime of how many other atrocities they undergo, but they never fail to give their fullest service to Krishna. They never expect anything. They only work for the satisfaction of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. We can see how Gopinath Patanayak, he was hanged on the lifted on the changa still. And we know how Vaninath Patanayak, the brother of Ramananda Rai, everybody was taken during that changa program. He was also, his whole family was arrested. But I was so inspired to read that how during that arrest, Vaninath Rai, he was chanting on both of his hands, fingers. He was counting on both of his fingers, chanting the holy names of the Lord and counting 1,000 times. And as when 1,000 times was finished, he used to make one mark on his body. So much surrender. Anya bilashita shunyam jnana karmadi anavritam. They had no other material desires. When Gopinath Patnaik was released, when by the mercy of Prataprudra, King Prataprudra, he got doubled. His salary was doubled. He got the same position. He got silken cloth wrapped around him, where once he was lifted on the changa to be killed by the prince, and now he's getting honored. So even at that time, when he went to Mahaprabhu and thanked for the supreme mercy indirectly which he got, he was repenting that his mercy was not the real mercy, because Ramananda Rai and Vaninath Rai, they became mendicants. They left everything, all their positions, all material opulence. But Gopinath Patnaik was given more material opulence. So even at that stage, instead of being so jubilant, Gopinath Patnaik was lamenting. So they were not interested in material opulence. They were fully surrendered because of Mahaprabhu. So na dhanam, na janam, na sundarim, nothing. And we know the pastime of Chota Haridas Thakur, how Mahaprabhu rejected him just for knowingly or unknowingly looking lustfully to a young woman. So Mahaprabhu was very strict. At the end, whatever we do, if we do our work in the expectation of good results, if we are attached to the results, like that pastime, that one pandit is there and he's so attached to the ancestral well. He's so attached to his father. He thinks his father is God. And he's so attached to the ancestral well. The well was built by the great-grandfather. And it was so muddy and there were so many bacteria. He would never allow his family members to drink water from that. He would never allow his family members to take water from other tube wells. Only from that well they have to drink. So all his family members were dying because of this bacteria and virus inside that ancestral well. But he was so obstinate and so adamant that when the villagers decided to demolish that well, then he came upon the well and he said, no, nobody can destroy it. So it was impossible. So that attachment, if we have that attachment to Krishna, we should not have attachment to the fruits of the results. If I give my exams, will I come first? Oh, I will join Krishna Bhakti when after my sons gets married. if I will join bhakti after I get my daughter married. So these pros and cons, this obligation should not hamper our any work. So our mood should be selfless, unmotivated. Because the Krishna has already coded everybody's lives. The consequences are already predestined. So why one should be attached or detached, attached the fruits of the work? We can work without any expectations of the results. There is a beautiful pastime. In ancient South Indian temples, Krishna was standing with his beautiful flute on his lips. So I'll end up with the story. So there, he had very good relationship with one sweeper in the temple. And both of them had a very good intimate relationship. And the sweeper was very feeling very pathetic and compassionate upon Krishna. He came upon to Krishna and he told, "Oh, my dear Lord, I'm feeling so bad that you're standing all day here. And you see, I'm working all day, but at the end, I go home and I sleep. I take good amount of rest. But I see you're always standing here and you don't have so much of work, but you're standing here. So I feel very bad. So can I do some service for you?" He's asking. So Krishna is like, because of intimacy, he's like, "Okay, no problem. Why not? Let us exchange our positions." So the sweeper comes onto the altar and he stands with the flute. And the Lord is out as a sweeper. But there was an agreement, there was a deal that the sweeper should not make any decisions. He should not make any deals, sort out any problems. So he said, "Okay, fine, no problem." So he stands on the altar and one rich man comes and he prays to the Lord. And he puts some 2,000 rupees on the donation box. And he prays. And he, while he's going, his wallet falls down. He goes. Then after that, one poor man comes. And he prays very intensely to the Lord. He puts some coins in the hundi. And he prays to the Lord that, "My dear Lord, my family is starving. We don't have any money even to eat. Please facilitate us something so that we can survive." So immediately as he goes, he looks upon that wallet and he thinks, "This is the mercy, this is the prasad of the Lord." And he accepts that wallet and he goes. And then after comes one sailor and he prays very intensely that may his ship go nicely, sail nicely with no wind blows and safely, because he was going to sail tonight. So, like this, everybody comes and prays. Meanwhile, the rich man realizes that he has lost his wallet. So he becomes so agitated and he comes upon with so many police, and he starts searching and they find nobody in the temple, but they find the sailor in the temple. So he tells. Rich man becomes very much angry and he says, "This is the man. Look, this is the man. He must be having my wallet." And they were just going to arrest the sailor. And the sweeper on the altar, the so-called Bhagavan, he becomes very much disturbed. And he thinks, "How can there be injustice going on in front of me?" So he becomes impatient and he tells that, no, wait, this is not the person who has taken your wallet. There was one poor man who was starving and he took the wallet and he must be on his way." So the things were clear and they all went and everything was done. So now it is Sandhyati time and they came back each other and they want to exchange their place. So Krishna asked, "So how was your day? Was it good?" So the sweeper says, "Oh, it was very tiring." So the Lord says, "Why, what happened?" He says, "No, I had to deal many things, I had to sort out many things." Then the Lord said, "Sort out? I told you we had a deal and agreement, right? What did you do that?" "I had to do, there was some injustice going on." He said, why you did some, justice?" Then he says, "What's wrong? There was injustice." Then he told the whole story, the sailor was going to get arrested and all these things. Then the Lord says, oh my God, what have you done? Because then the sweeper says, what have I done, my dear Lord? Please tell me. He says, I have already arranged everything. You know, the rich man who came, he's going to die within few days. And he has not done many good activities, pious activities. So I thought, okay, he drops his wallet, and that wallet will go to the poor man, because, and he'll get one piety in his life. So when he goes to Chitragupta, he has some pious activities for him. So I was merciful on that rich man. And because the poor man, he was starving. So I thought, okay, in this way, he will get money and he can maintain his family. And the sailor, if he was going to go today on the ship, but today the ship was going to sink, drown. So I had to get him arrested. So tonight he will be there and he can be saved. So everything was pre-planned and arranged, but everything we have destroyed. So the conclusion is that everything is pre-planned, predestined. The consequences, everything is predestined by the Lord. So what is our struggle and what is our hard work, or what is that we have done? We are nothing. We are instruments. We are only puppets in the hands of puppeteer. Krishna is the ultimate puppeteer. So not hankering for the results. We should be anashrita. We should not take shelter of the results. Although it is very difficult, but we will be hearing more ahead how to do that. And firmly fix our mind at the lotus feet of the Lord. And today is Narottam Das Thakur's disappearance day. So let us all beg his mercy. He is personification of Krishna Prem. When Mahaprabhu was shouting, looking at Bangladesh side, Narottam, Narottam, then all the associates of Mahaprabhu, they thought that, oh, Mahaprabhu, whom he is calling, he must be calling Purushottam Jagannath. But he was calling Narottam. And he placed the Krishna Bhakti, Krishna Prema in the Padma River. Then Padma River says, how can I recognize Narottam? He said that when somebody comes into your Padma River, you will get ecstatic symptoms. That is the person whom you have to give this Krishna Prema. So this Krishna Prema, Narottam Das Thakur, is the personification of Krishna Prema. So let us seek today his blessings. He has written so many bhajans, prarthana, and so many books. One of the favorite bhajans of Srila Prabhupada is Hari Hari Bifale Janam Go Naina. This Manushya Jeevan is very rare, rarest of the rare. So we should not waste it by drinking this poison. If we don't take it to Krishna Bhakti, our lives are simply useless. So thank you very much. Here I would like to end. If there are any comments, any corrections, please, you can guide me. Hare Krishna.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mother. So if anyone has any questions or comments, you can unmute and say something. All right. So thank you very much. Good class. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Hare Krishna.
Thanks.